Yeah.
In order to paint an actual human picture, you have to give your most honest account of all sides. And music left me in a place where I can be as honest as possible. So I write. Let me just get like a dark joint. Yeah, I want that Caribbean dark.
Tell me about the song real quick.
Huh?
Tell me about the song real quick. When was the first time you heard it?
Oh my God. The timing. I heard this, I was a kid. What was this, 99 this song came out?
Yeah.
The video for this, I remember I was sitting in Tacoma Park in this room. I don't necessarily remember what room it was, but I was in this room. And I remember seeing the fake Bill Clinton on the TV screen.
Okay.
But it was Eminem. And I remember just getting like sucked into it. Just like, what? it was less the theatrics and more just how it worked in with what he was saying lyrically. And it was like, how did these two things, how were they able to—
like how he was so animated?
Perfect.
What do you say that influenced the way you write?
Yeah.
Because Eminem.
That's my girl, dog.
Yeah.
I don't give a fuck. I said be the pistol world, dog. Yeah.
Because the thing about Eminem is that he's always rapping from different characters. And one thing that I noticed about your, like the way you write is that you also take, you're never just necessarily writing from your perspective. You're also writing from different angles. And also about Eminem, at the time it was, even now, like his lyrics are just like when you listen to it, like, okay, what the fuck did I just hear, you know? With you, the way that you write, it's extremely open and there's no questions to be asked. Do you feel like with Eminem, did that kind of give you the confidence to be a little more open with your writing?
Absolutely. Like it was crazy kind of how it worked, right? So like you have Jay-Z and Eminem. In fact, Jay-Z was actually the one that had brought me into the world of hip hop first.
Really?
Yeah, I remembered the song like it was yesterday. It's Hovi Baby. It was on Blueprint 2 and he said, I'm so far ahead of my time, I'm about to start another life. Look behind you, I'm about to pass you twice. Back to the future, gotta slow up for my present. I'm fast, so niggas can't get past my past. So how to propose to deal with my perfect present? It was like,
goat.
I heard that.
Goat.
And then I heard the way Eminem came on Renegade, and I was like, there's a marriage here of a language of communication that just hasn't been able to like be presented in its truest form yet. Like
100%.
Like Eminem is just very, very raw with the way that he was able to spit it, but Jay-Z has an intellectual like foundation behind the way that he presents his. And if you can mesh those two things together, you can make anything happen. That's how I thought about it.
And that's and that has like a direct influence on like how you write right now.
Absolutely.
You also draw a lot of influence from Kanye.
Yeah.
Talk to me about that.
I got mental illness and it's something that I've dealt with for ever since I was a kid, like literally before anybody knew it was a thing or even it became anything that was worth taking into consideration whenever you're approaching a person. And it was like Kanye just has this ability to be himself without wondering or worrying about. And that this isn't to say that he doesn't worry about how people receive him, but it's like the forefront of him is he's him. And he's comfortable in just being that, whatever that is. That's how I felt with it. You know what I'm saying? It's like you can have the confidence of being able to do something, but do you have the confidence in yourself to even be able to present the ideas you have? Because if you don't, you're still stuck.
Would you say that you draw, because in terms of your production, you're really versatile.
The thing is, it's like, it's a mix, right? So I'm like Kanye in the way where I can make beats and I do make beats. I have two beat tapes out, but I will mix in things that I would make in between things that I find from other producers.
Yeah.
Like I started with piano, so I have an ear for music. I have an understanding of it. And anytime that I want to present something, I take a lot of things into consideration. Like not just the emotion or the feeling behind something, but like just the timbre of my voice. Is it going to sit well in this pocket of melodies? Is this going to sound good? Am I going to be able to convey it the way I want it to? Like all of these things, even when I'm writing, like those are the things that are coming in my head. I could find a beat and be like, oh, this is cool, this is dope, but like, it just doesn't speak to me.
Yeah, so in turn, and you're also a drummer too, right?
Yeah.
Which way do you find the best expression of yourself? Through the piano or the drums? In terms of getting out the emotion.
I would like to say that depends, but I don't know. Because piano gives me an accessibility to myself that I can't have drumming. Drumming and being a drummer is like being a provider. It's like being a caretaker. You're holding things together.
Yeah.
That's the purpose of the rhythm. So you always function within a particular bracket of time when you're working with other people. So it's like drumming puts me in a place where I can express the feelings that are like more prominent.
Yeah.
And piano lets me express the feelings that are more internal. That makes sense?
Yeah, no, definitely. Yeah. Because I mean, the piano in itself, it's more about melodies and kind of like expressing that, where in terms of drumming, you can fine tune a drum to make it sound like melodic, like a piano.
Yeah.
But also you can bash the fuck out of like a snare and a kick and make it sound like a war, you know? So in terms of, when beat making, does the beat influence the lyrics or vice versa?
The beat.
The beat?
The beat comes first.
The beat comes first for you?
Yeah. I'll hear a beat and then I'll write the song.
So it depends about the feeling you get from the beat.
Yeah.
What's your starting point with the beat? Like, are you
melodies? It's gonna be funny, but some people do it. I'm a melody guy.
Okay.
If I don't have the right melody, I won't be able to make the right beat. I've made a dope beat and it didn't have the right melody. And I was like, this is kind of weird. I should probably swap out this sample. And then I was like, yes.
Yeah, 100%. Dude, like, if you can put the sickest drum pattern on, like the most obnoxious shit, but if you can't find the right sample to put it over, it's just like,
it's not gonna
sound. You're not doing it justice at all.
Yeah.
So what's your process of finding a sample? Like, do you make your own samples or are you crate digging?
It's a mix. It's a mix of everything. Like, I made this song called Heliosphere. I made the beat. I didn't tell anyone I did it at the time, but like, I made the beat and it was, the way that I did it was actually a Japanese jazz band, and there was a piece of it that I actually time stretched and I down tuned in order for it to sound the way it sounded. That's what that is. It's just a repeat of that over and over again. And then I threw the drums on top of that.
How old were you first started producing?
I started doing that first, so it's probably like 15.
So you were producer, then turned rapper.
Like, I always wrote, but music was always a starting point for me. So it was like, I liked being able to create the sounds in my head because the lyrics don't always, you can say a lot of things, but like, you can't always understand things based on what something is said. Like, the songs that I've cried the hardest to have not been in English.
That's interesting. It's purely on the feeling.
Yeah.
Like, you weren't even understanding what was being said. It was just on how it made you feel.
It's how it made me feel. And I was able to like piece it together, like in my head as I'm doing it. Like, the way that my brain works is like, I'm having a conversation. So when the lyrics coming out, and that conversation had already been had. So I'm just kind of like, it's like being a stenographer in a way. You're just kind of like writing what you hear.
That's crazy. So
also,
when you first started recording, you were recording off a video camera.
Yep.
And you ripped out the audio.
And I put it in Audacity.
Audacity?
Yeah. Yeah.
So I guess, how do you learn the skills that you have right now?
Oh man, I was kind of forced into a position where I had to. There's a rapper that I knew, a fairly famous rapper, and I had asked him to show me how to do mixing, and he was like, nah, and I was like, okay.
I feel like a lot of artists are put in the position where you're not even juggling just the music, you're juggling the music, the mixing, the PR, the marketing, the branding.
Yeah, I've had to learn everything myself. That's how I learned the difference between mechanical and performance royalties, getting fucked over.
How do you manage to juggle everything?
I don't have a choice.
It's literally just out of like, it's more like, a survival.
Yeah, it's not like I haven't had help in certain instances. You know, when I got my first mic, it was a dude named Billy. He had a YouTube channel called Terry Hesicles. It was funny, and he had a bunch of underground music on it. And he heard my music. I put up like an MF Doom cover and some other shit. And he was like, yo, this is dope. And then we started communicating like that. And then he and another homie named Simon Said sent me a mic. It was when I had my first mic. At the time, I was using a Rock Band mic until then.
Damn.
Yeah.
A Rock Band mic?
I used a Rock Band mic for volume one.
Bullshit.
And part of volume two. Yeah. That was 2011, 2012. I didn't have
a
mic then.
That's fucking crazy. A Rock Band mic?
Yeah.
So like
I used a Rock Band mic. So I had a Rock Band mic and I had a USB mic and both of those were plugged into Mixcraft. So I was just trying to figure out, this is before I even understood what the fuck busing and compression was. So it's like, okay, this is what really put it there for me was LP. Like watching that, the Revenge of the Robot shit, like you see like, wow, y'all were in 1998 and y'all were using dynamic mics to record this shit? How? What year is it? I'm sure that this mic has somewhat similar or the same capacity, if not more than what y'all were using then. So I have to be able to figure out exactly what range to work with this in order to be able to make it be tailored to what I wanted it to do.
So it was more so, are the survival tactics that you learned as a young artist just coming up still push you through today?
Yeah, because it made it so, remember, it's like everything just stacked on each other. So I just build. So it's like, oh, okay, now that I know how to use this type of mic, now I can understand how to use this type of mic. Okay, yeah. Since I use these two types of mic, now I know what the range is to do this. So maybe since my voice is higher at this point, then if I, you know, raise these hertz or I lower these and then I make it like this and I can have a set like this and compression does this. It's like, it was a lot of just like trial and error and trying to understand.
It's experimentation.
And then I went to school. So I actually went to Musicians Institute in LA and I was there for like a year and a half and I learned like actual like music. So it was like, okay, so you record drums like this. So compression does this. So if a snare isolates the sound, then if my voice is at the same hertz that the snare may be, then maybe I can make a compression sound like this and that. It's just a lot of like...
experimentation.
Yeah.
There's a bunch of experimentation.
Bless.
But talk to me real quick. So you were born and raised in DC, right?
Yeah, I was born in... Ooh, yes. Tacoma Park. And Tacoma Park Okay. Obviously is like a suburb of DC.
Yeah.
But yeah, I was like right over the line. I was born in Washington and Venice Hospital. And then I grew up in Southeast.
How is it like, you tweeted something out very interesting that when I read it, I was like, this could be a fucking thesis statement. And it kind of ties into how DC's been developing.
Yeah.
You tweeted out one day, I don't know if you remember this, the gentrification of lo-fi.
Yeah. You know how I found the sound that I found? Mm. So everybody knows Nujabes, right?
Yeah.
I spoke to Nujabes on MySpace when I had my poetry blog. And obviously there's like small kind of like, you spoke Japanese, I spoke this, but I was a fan of your stuff and I reached out and it happened. So there was able to, and from there, and learning more of his music and what he likes sampling and what he made with jazz hop, then it was like, but then there's the anime aspect, the Samurai Champloo, which was added on that. Now we know where that culture is from.
Yeah.
We know where that's from.
Yes.
We know where hip hop's from.
Yes.
There's always been this weird dancing around each other when it's been about it, right?
Yeah.
It's like you'll hear elements of hip hop and old anime and you'll hear anime references from rappers.
Yes.
But there the marriage didn't actually happen. Nujabes and J Dilla were capable of making that happen. They made that happen.
Dilla's a god to me.
And then you get your Nujabes, you get your Fat John, you get your Suchi. These are all the people that produced the sounds for the Samurai Champloo, which was what started what we now know as lo-fi.
Exactly.
But that's not what it sounds like now, right?
100%
no. Exactly. So they were 100%. Able to take elements of it that they knew was what it was and then be able to popcorn it. And then you were able to get these kids that got in a specific position, like, oh, you had money for marketing, you did whatever. So now you're a gatekeeper. And now you can only let certain people that are your friends or do certain things be allowed into certain areas of the community. I see the separation because I see a lot of people that have been working their asses off from the beginning, like Marcus D. I respect him like shit as a producer. He was there with Nujabes. They were friends. And it's like, and I remember one day he tweeted out and he was like, yo, I don't understand where these kids are making 1 million, 2 million Spotify listeners and no one knows who you are. How does that happen? How does that happen? Yeah. Well, the same way when I go to DC, I go, yo, how did you get a house on the same block that I was scared to walk down? But how are you now making it so that I can't go there? How does that work? It's the same exact concept. They took it, flipped it, made it something that was easily to access.
And then they denied your access.
Boom. So then when people ask, they're like, oh, why haven't you gotten a big playlist? Because they don't like my voice. Literally, I've gotten that as a response. Oh, really? I don't like your voice. Yeah.
But I mean, your voice is really like, you hit a lot of different pockets. Like, you have the aggressive heavy metal influence, but it's also it's like volume four. Like I was just playing, it's extreme, like it fits the mold of your lo-fi.
Now imagine myself and people that were doing this from 2010, 2011 to now be where it is in 2020. And we're like, you want me to pay what for a playlist? You want me to do what? I think one of the craziest things was seeing people that were fans of me blow up because of what connections they had in the community that I was a part of with other producers. I remember meeting Mind Design for the first time at Space 1520 in LA. Mm. I remember the first time I used one of his beats, I was like, this shit is dope. It was 2012. It was the song I did, I think it was in middle school. And I put the Chio Chance reference from Azumanga Daio in it. And I was like, oh yeah, I definitely found a pocket. This is sick. And I was like, I gotta find this person. And we were all connected. Where I was with the homies like Shango and Vader and Connor and all the homies were directly connected into that community. John Wayne used to go by the crib all the time.
Really?
Right when I left, John Wayne was always over there. I've met Zero. Like, it wasn't so far separate. I left DC and I went to LA where it was actually happening. Nobody knew what was really going on with that movement because it was over in LA.
Yeah.
That was when Dumbfounded was really still hopping. No Can Do had just dropped, I think, what is it? Zero something. I forgot what the name of that album was. But that was around the time where Team Backpack was even still a really big thing. And there was a whole other subculture and style of hip hop that was meshed with jazz hip hop, boom bap, anime, and because of how it was created, was how the lo-fi came out. It wasn't something that you made because you threw an analog filter on it. It was because of how
you put off the high ends.
It was how you were making it. Well, why does volume one sound like that? Because I made it on a Rock Band mic.
Yeah.
In a room where the mattress was well on one side and I had the beats gotten from, you know, Ripped or another homie that I met is sending me an MP3, and that the lo-fi sound was from an actually being low fidelity.
He literally, yeah. Like, you forget the definition of it.
Yeah, it was literally that. So it's now able to see, and it's like really crazy too, because I remember I saw a fan that like, he heard some of volume four and he was like, oh yeah, I think it's cool. It just sounds like mainstream lo-fi. And I was like.
Yeah, it's not even that. Like you just said.
Yeah.
You're really influenced by anime. And I mean, that's the entire premise of
anime and every single producer that did it before me, because that's who started it. It started with the sound. It was production. It was the sound. It was the chop. It was the cuts. It was the low pass filters on thing. It was the sound. I was just an addition.
Yeah. What was your first exposure to anime?
I was a kid. My very first anime that I remember was Evangelion. But it was Evangelion and Sailor Moon. I'm not sure which one came first, but Evangelion, like I remember when I first saw it, it was like my big bro, he was like, he's a homie. And he was like drawing, I think Ava 1 or 2. And I was like, what the fuck is that? He was like, it's this. And he showed me, and he has like this bag full of like just ripped DVDs of anime and hentai that he got from his cousin that was overseas in Japan. That's how I got it.
And that was your first exposure to
it? That was my first real exposure and understanding of it.
Because through volume one through volume four, I'm not gonna say the name because I'm gonna butcher it.
Yeah.
I'm gonna call it volume one through volume four.
Yeah.
The entire storyline is based on a vampire that's consuming.
You understand? Yeah. It's like, because the face of it is Senju Gahara, and it's like, if you look into her personality, it's like, her personality is very, very like, just cathartic and just raw and just, I don't care. But then you have the character Araragi, who is the vampire, and you want to understand like, well, what is the nature of the relationship? And you end up finding out that it actually kind of starts with him losing his own sense of self, like him being a vampire and how he turned back. It's like, it's just so crazy. It's like the whole basis of the whole series of volumes was me not only actually writing down what I was experiencing through relationships, but it was a way of trying to convey the other side of it, where it's kind of like, I feel like a lot of times people give like a very me perspective of everything. It's like, oh, well, I went through this and this is because of this. And like, for me, it was kind of like, well, I think it would be very unfair for the people that I was involved with to make it seem like anything that it ended was solely because of them, because it's not the truth.
Yeah.
In order to paint an actual human picture, you have to give your most honest account of all sides. And music left me in a place where I can be as honest as possible. So I write it out.
You have the album Analogs, where, and this shit is like, when I looked into it, I was like, holy shit. Like, you put a lot of thought into the character play and kind of builds on that point where you're speaking from different perspectives and the end mission is the sun.
Yeah.
But along the mission, you run into certain anomalies.
In different places.
In different places. And you write in the perspective of those places.
What it feels like being there. That's why Cupid's belt is Cupid's belt, because Cupid's belt is cold.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So tying that back into you, what would you say were the monumental experiences that kind of that's have and still shape your journey right now?
I think it's the learning process. Like, it's really weird because, like, as an artist, you kind of have to be like egocentric to a way, in a way.
In a certain, in a certain respect.
But it's like at the same time, you have to have an understanding of other people in the space outside of you. So like making music puts me in a position where I can like understand that space and understand, that's the whole goal. For me personally, like before I did all of this, I wanted to do what Vice was doing. Before Vice was Vice, I wanted to be a traveling journalist. So when I would go places.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I would talk to the oldest people that I knew there and I would love just listening to their stories because that's how you understand things, right? It's through generation. Music was my way of being able to do that because I couldn't do it. So it's like I go different places and I tell you a story, and in exchange, you'll probably tell me a story, which is usually what happens. I go and I do a show, and then a fan or someone comes up, they're like, yo, man.
Yeah, and I'm 1, 2, 3, 4.
Thank you. Like, it's the connection and the communication.
But here's the thing. I really do feel like, I won't say you're an anomaly. I do feel like artists like you exist, but you're one of the rare exceptions that you kind of understand your humanity in all of this. And it's like, you're not really scared to be vulnerable to your fans. And you really have like a very personal relationship to your fans. But also, me personally, right? Mm-hmm. I like operating from like a private domain.
Yeah.
I don't want you to know everything about me. Mm-hmm. Do you feel like being as open as you are with your lyrics and with your fans, do you feel like sometimes you sacrifice on that private domain?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Even like, I had to explain, like, I'm gonna just crack the code here.
Yeah, right? No, go for it.
I'm gonna crack the social media code. It's social fucking media. It's social media. It's social media. That's it. That's all it is. You have to understand that it's social and it's media. It's you're consuming something. Yeah. It's a form of fucking entertainment.
It's literally.
So you can't expect to know everything. Now, what you were saying, right? I am pretty with my fans because that's my way of saying, hey, I want y'all to understand that there's still a real person here. That's it. You gotta understand there's still a real person. Like, there's a line. There's a line. So now there's a level of respect that me and my fans have. Because I'm gonna respect you and you're gonna respect me.
Yeah.
That's it. I see the way that it is with other artists where people be saying all types of weird shit. I will have fans say weird shit and my fans be like, nah, that's not one of us. We're not cool with that.
Yeah, I've seen that. I've literally seen that firsthand.
Because that's what it's supposed to be like.
Yeah.
If you have an artist that you like, that you're putting energy in, that you're putting money on, that you're putting time on, you're investing in them. Do you know how unfair it is? I remember there was a story. It was, I think it was Future and Joe Budden was talking about it. He's talking about how Future had stopped drinking lean and he didn't say anything and he was still making music about it. And then like his fans were like, and I understood that from a personal perspective. Cause like when you listen to someone, you're connecting with them. You're hoping that they are what you're connecting to as they're presenting it to you. You know how unfair that is? To just sell you a fucking dream the whole time that you're investing in me? That's shitty. That's really shitty. You're actively manipulating your fans to give you what you want and they never feel fulfilled.
Yeah, because you're selling false promises.
Why am I going to do that? If you know that, if you listen to my music and you're like, oh yeah, this dude is dealing with depression and you come and talk to me about depression, I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about, you're going to feel some type of way.
Yeah.
Why am I going to do that to you?
So going off on that, so I mean, it really is no secret that a lot of your music is based around mental health, based around loss. Do you feel like when you're crafting a song, or when you're crafting songs in particular, are the albums kind of a vessel for you to kind of put all this emotion into? Like, is it a form of therapy for you?
Yeah, it helps me. One thing that they say to do is to, like, talk to people, right? You gotta talk. And I don't necessarily always agree with that.
Yeah.
But I will say, in the position of being an artist, I can talk freely.
Yes.
And no one will ever question what I'm saying, because they'll either go to, oh, that's just the art. That's the one issue that I've had. But that it also works to my advantage, because people are able to consume it in a way that fits them. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly. Yeah. It fits. Yeah. Like, it fits their own personal mold.
As it should. And that's okay.
Because I feel like the problem with when you're talking, like, on wax to someone about mental health and depression, people have this misunderstanding that it's like this kind of linear relationship, that it's like, oh, but you were feeling good yesterday.
So
why are you sad today?
See?
And it's like,
I just had that conversation.
Yeah, it's like it's more so of a cyclic repetition. It's like, yeah, one day you might feel better, but there's still that cloak of depression over it. So I just find it really interesting that it's like, you're really not afraid to show your humanity through your art. And on that, it's like, you've been consistent for like 10 years. Like, I'm always, so I followed you back last year. I found you on Bandcamp.
Hey, yeah, I found you on Bandcamp.
When I first started the series, I was like, okay, who's from the area that I want to bring in? And you were like number one on Bandcamp. And then I go to your YouTube page and I'm like, holy shit. Cause usually, like, when you're talent scouting, you're usually looking at like artists who like have a couple songs out, an album out. You have albums, you have podcasts, you have vlogs, you have gaming shit. You have some gaming streams. And you're extremely active on social media. You're always interacting with the fans. What motivates that consistency? Because as, you know, as creatives, being a creative person, when you're putting all you got into your work and in your head you're setting these like expectations and you're not meeting them, yeah, it's always daunting. It's, yeah, like a cycle of feeling daunting. So it's,
you
like,
get it.
I'm in this shit. So,
but a lot of people can't explain it. You're doing very well explaining.
Oh, appreciate you. But like, how do you keep going? Is my question.
I don't have a choice. Like, I did. Like, okay. Volume 4 was like probably one of the most accurate and most direct deconstructions of how I'm actually feeling. Like, for example,
yeah, 100%.
I've lied to you long enough. That song is actually about, yes, go ahead.
No, I was gonna say, you mentioned that was like the most important song in the album.
That song was about the fact that I had lied to people about what I felt to keep them happy, who I was to keep them happy, and what I was doing to keep myself protected. Like, that song starting off, where the lie is at, where the lie is, yeah, at, it's literally about, hey, everybody at some point has made a justification to why they lied about something. But when everything comes to a head and it blows up in your face, you have to recognize everything about it. So that's what happened. And regardless of your reason, it always comes to a head. And it came to a head, and I was like, well, who am I actually? And then I saw it, and I was like, okay. That song was about finding it. That's why I was like, at the end, it's like, I'm glad you're here for the epilogue. Like,
no,
gaslight another fire, now you blown because of my shit. Because that line is specifically about what happens when they talk about speaking and relationships and whatever. It's about gaslighting. So it's about, you believe something, and I'm telling you it's not, even though we both know what it is.
Yeah.
I started a fire. Now you blown because of my shit. High now because I'm childish. Glad you're here for the epilogue. So it ended.
So that was kind of like you putting a nail in the coffin of like hiding who you are and just like being like uncompromisable and like, this is me in my full, like, in all my entropy. Embrace it.
Yeah, you got to leave. It's like, I got to a point where it's like, shit happened. It was like, there's a point where you gotta like really like come to terms with certain things. Like, yeah. I feel like people spend so much time running away from themselves because they want to find happiness, and it's the pursuit of happiness. But you can't pursue something if, like, it's like, I feel like a lot of times people dream that they're further ahead than they actually are. And it's like, the easiest way is to be real with yourself, at least. And I know that with myself, my music was my way of not getting lost in the lies I was telling. It was like, at least there's a timeline of how I always have felt. Anything I've ever done, anything I've ever felt, it's documented right here. So if you ever want to question anything, just go listen to it. It's right there. You want to see the lyrics? I'll write it for you. at the cure his belt. You don't really, really need this. I don't want to see you go. It's odd to the sequence, and we just offer the X and O. Add an E into something that's close. Loving you when I smoke that drove. Only lie because I'm scared to know what the fuck's with the lame excuses. Ain't shit guessing the same as you and find the love and the girls you knew. And it's like,
bro, get him a mic real quick.
That was it. Like, literally. But it's like, yeah. And I feel like a lot of times, like, people just, man, it's like, I get that people, everybody has their own relationship with honesty, and sometimes it's too much.
Yeah.
I get that. Like, everybody, like, just coming from the perspective of being a nigga, like, it was too much. People were like, oh my God, you're actually dying. Yes, dog, we've been here.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And it's like having to deal with that, and then having to have dealt with having depression since I was a kid.
And when you're a kid, you don't even know what to call it.
Because no one else knows what to call it.
Exactly.
What if I told you I didn't find that shit out till this year because I saw it on a medical document? My parents didn't tell me that. So I've been dealing with it the whole time, thinking I'm crazy. And then to finally come to this place where we're at now in 2020, and everybody's forced to see these things because now we're stuck inside.
Yeah.
It's crazy. We had to be stuck inside to see reality. That's how fucked up and distracted everything.
Yeah, all of a sudden, like, oh, what's police brutality?
Oh my God, this is happening? That's bizarre.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like, nah, dog, that's been happening.
It's been here.
Yeah,
it's
like, your wife has been miserable, bro. Like, pay attention. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
You gotta see shit. And it's like, even if you don't wanna see it, it's like, it's not gonna go away because you just don't wanna see it. Like, I remember I had a homie, my little brother, his name was Vader. He passed away.
Rest in peace, I'm sorry for that.
Vader was the best rapper alive. And I'm saying that just flat out. And that doesn't even have anything to do with who he was as a person, because he was still who he was. Like, we would argue, if you did piece of shit things, you're my brother, I love you regardless. But when you get certain things taken from you, it's different.
Yeah.
Like, when you get things taken, it's different. It's a much different relationship versus when you're giving something, or if something happens incidentally. It's much different. So him being taken and then me having to drop analogs, and he was supposed to be on it. Yeah. Right. So it's like, it put my brain in a space where I had a relationship, even since I was young, I had a relationship with death and just life and the understanding of it. But it made it more real. It's like when you're able to taste it and it becomes tangible, you have a different relationship with it. And I don't run from that. It is what it is. I grew up in DC. People were getting shot all the time. Walk outside. Unfortunately, if you look like me, you get shot, you know? And then there's the actual life where you wake up missing your mom. Like, people want you to be something that makes them feel the most comfortable being around you. So if they want to be happy, you're not happy, then they're going to kind of be weird with you because you're not fitting the idea.
They're not fitting their mold.
Exactly.
In terms of growing up in DC, mm-hmm. you've seen the city.
Yeah.
Like, flip 180.
Yeah, and I left too. I left and came back, and niggas was like, you're not from here. I went through that period.
Really?
Yeah.
So almost feel like a stranger in your own home.
Absolutely. Because DC is a very, like, it's a community. There's love. Regardless of what people think, like, for us, it's love. It's music. It's culture. It's a lot there.
Yeah.
That you have to be a part of to actually understand. So I left. I grew up in Southeast. Yeah, where you grew up? Oh, Alabama Avenue. Damn, that shit is crazy, bro. Yeah, my bro was telling a story about how, like, there was a group of us when we were younger. We played this game called Nigga Knockers, which is essentially Ding Dong Ditch, but instead of knocking, you'll kick the door. And we were doing that in Southeast. Some dude, you know, do, 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 do. Some dude was like, hey, yo, pulled out the hatchet, and we ran. That was a story that just stayed with the school. I went to DuPont Park. And we ended up talking about it, like, the homie's little brother brought it up, and I was like, oh yeah, I was with the homies that did it. He was like, what the fuck is wrong with you? And it's funny thinking about the things we did for fun that was also in the midst of places where you could very easily lose your life.
Like, yeah, like actual dangers. Like,
I had many people that didn't make it.
Like, and that's a reality.
That's a reality. I had a girl I had a crush on that I used to ride the bus with from Potomac Avenue on the M6 to where I was on Massachusetts Avenue that didn't make it. So like I said, my understanding of death isn't from the perception of like, oh man, it's so bad. It's like things happen, but at the same time, you have to understand that we don't understand everything.
Yeah.
We're afraid of the things that we don't understand, but if you don't explore it, then you're not gonna understand it. So if you see a bunch of white people that are afraid to look inside themselves and see that they're racist and that their families are racist, then we're gonna keep dying.
Until everyone, like, really has, like, a self-talk with themselves.
And that's really all it's about. You have COVID. There's a virus out here. shut the fuck up, sit inside, do some research on yourself, get better. And then when everything is over, everything could be a better place. But instead of doing that, everyone just wants to rush things. Everyone wants to fight. Everyone wants to be on social media talking bullshit. Like, ugh. It's like, why?
It's so much to handle. It's so much to handle. And it's like, quarantine should still be a thing. But yeah. Like, clearly, it's really not.
You got to live your life, though. I understand that. But like, when I see people say things like, oh, I'm not going to wear a mask because I feel healthy. It's like, ah, oh, you selfish asshole.
Yeah, exactly. Literally. It's like, you don't get this shit, do you? How have you been keeping up in quarantine?
Me personally?
Yeah.
Oh, dog, I stay inside. Like, when I after I left the bar that I was working at, I stayed inside. Cool. This is my life. Chilling.
Oh, so you're working at a bar before?
Yeah. I was working at a bar like, what was it, like a year and a half ago. Mm-hmm. And then I left and then started just grinding on my shit. For real, for real. It's like, actually, at the time I made the bar, it was like right before I quit. It was when I finished Sorry to Bother You.
Really?
Yeah.
Is music your full-time thing now?
Yeah. I would like it to be even more of a full-time thing, but I'm maneuvering it. With what I have now and like just with the help that I have now, I'm in a space where I can do what I need to and focus on it the way I need to.
Yeah, so I was going to ask that. So you were independent before. And now you signed to...
I'm still independent.
Oh, you're still independent.
Yeah. Like, oh, okay. So, like, essentially, it's like Sprite picked up some artists. That's what happened. They picked up some artists and were like, hey, we're going to give you this and this and this, if you know? And I was like, okay, cool. Like, I still have control over my shit. It's not like I'm, like, on a label on there, like, releasing my music or... No, it's nothing like that.
Do you see yourself staying independent?
Fuck yeah. Because I understand. It's like, it's like... Every inch I make, I'm like, ooh, the business, oh, okay, so this isn't really this. This is just the same thing as this. It just seems like it has a different definition because I don't know what that word is. It's like blue and blue, right?
Yeah.
Literally, that's what fucking business is. It's like blue and blue. It's different jargon. It's a different language. You understand it, everything else starts clicking. Like, no, for example, perpetuity. That's a word. What does that mean? Forever. So if you see that on your contract, you're going to be like, nah, dog.
Not forever.
But because you don't know these words or this language, you get lost in it.
So how have you been picking like the team around you?
I have had one PR team. Shout out to Candace. Candace, if you see this ever. She was the best that I've ever had. Like, she was like... We spoke for 6 months before she did my campaign. She did analogs.
Really?
Yeah. And she left who she was with. They separated in their thing. And she stopped doing PR. And since then, I just haven't had anyone. So I've just been, I took from what she had, learned from what she learned. But then all the contacts she had, it all changed. You know, most of the time, like, these contacts, these emails change, like, every 6 months, maybe a year. So when she was gone, all the contacts were gone, and I had to start over again. I actually got fucked over because I was going through the same PR with different people. And I actually wrote about it in the song Violate. And like right when I signed the contract, they disappeared. And I was like, oh, okay, cool. That's weird. And then they never moved forward with the campaign for that. So I was like, all right, cool. So since then, I've just been learning what I could and just gone with that.
What's next for you right now?
Doing what I can. Like, really, because I feel like the honest side of everything is that people just don't want to admit the fact that a lot of times they're just existing because you have to be this person all the time. You have to always, you know, but nah, dog, I'm existing. Just like anyone else. Like, yeah, there may be different qualities about me or different talent, whatever the fuck, but like, I'm a person. I'm existing. I'm sad. I'm dealing with it. I'm grinding. Some people make it, some people don't. The hope is that you do.
So in terms of, so you brought a shirt with you.
Yeah, I did.
Is that
nah, not talking you. About nah, that?
So when's that dropping?
When is the shirt dropping?
Yeah.
It's dropping this month.
This month?
Yeah, it's dropping this month. It is my first generation Airospace shirts. Never have I ever had a t-shirt ever. And I decided to do one based on Sorry to Bother You. So I was like, all right, cool. Let's add like a little bit of the yeah in there.
Do you have anything else in terms of music planning coming on the way, or are you just trying to feel the waves right now? Because you just released volume 4.
Yeah, I actually have a single coming out the 17th.
You had Burial come out before, no?
Yeah, I have another song coming out this month.
Oh shit, so you staying like...
Yeah, I'm gonna be that guy one time. I have to do just one time. Like, you know, they'd be like, yeah, dog, I got mad songs in the stash, bro.
That's but you really
I got
do.
Songs in the stash. Yeah.
So that's coming out the 17th?
Yeah, I have like a whole album in the stash.
You're just waiting for the right time?
if I like it still by the time, like, I'll make songs and I'll be like, oh, this is good. And then I'll do something much better than that whole album. I'm like, ah, fuck up.
I really appreciate you coming through.
Thanks for having
me. I really appreciate you sitting down and talking. Check out my guy. You on Instagram, Twitter.
Everything. You type in Airospace on Google, AIROSPACE, everything else will come up.
Just Google it.
Google it.
And check out, keep watch for the merch coming out later this month.
Yeah.
Cheers to that, my guy.
Cheers, bro. Thank you.